Hi, if you're new here and you're interested in ancient inventions or ancient structures, ancient queens, theories surrounding the ancient world, human evolution, or you want to hear the latest news about the archaeological discoveries, then subscribe to the channel, click that bell icon to be notified whenever I upload, and maybe consider becoming a Patreon or a channel member. It's time to change the current known historic timeline when it comes to the arrival of us, modern humans, or Homo sapiens, in Europe. The timeline needs to be altered and pushed back 10,000 years at least, as new evidence has come to light in a cave in France. My name is Kaylee, and in this video we're going to take a look into the newly discovered evidence in France that changes the historic timeline about the arrival of Homo sapiens in Europe. And this changes history quite significantly. So first, let's take a quick look at the location where this evidence has come to light and what this reveals about Homo sapiens and Neanderthals, because it's quite an important discovery. The evidence of earlier occupation by Homo sapiens in Europe was discovered in a cave, known as the Mandrin Cave, to be exact. And this cave is located near Montelimar in the Rhone region of southern France. So yeah, my French kind of sucks. Very much. Forgive me. In this cave, the archaeologists discovered the fossilized remains of Homo sapiens and their tools, sandwiched between the fossilized remains and tools of Neanderthals. So to recap, Neanderthals lived in Europe from approximately 400,000 years ago, give or take, until approximately 35,000 years ago. Again, give or take a few thousand years on both ends, we have to go off of the fossil records, and as I've stated numerous times now, the fossil record cannot give us exact dates, because conditions need to be perfect for specimen to become fossilized and able for us to, you know, radiocarbon date. So up until this new information, it was always believed that Homo sapiens entered Europe approximately 45,000 years ago, and that these two species, or lineages, or whatever you want to call them, lived together for some 5 or 10,000 years. Which is why there are people who believe that Neanderthals went extinct because of Homo sapiens, that Homo sapiens were the root cause of Neanderthals disappearing. Some people even think that Homo sapiens murdered Neanderthals and drove them to extinction. Others believe that Homo sapiens were able to procreate much faster and therefore outbred Neanderthals, maybe even interbred a lot, and thus Neanderthals were dissolved into the Homo sapiens lineage, species, whatever. I don't know. Of course, none of these theories can be proven, and this is not the subject of today's video, it's a subject for another video. But I did want to mention them quickly, because instead of these two species living together in the same area for no more than 10,000 years, it is now clear that they were living in the same area for at least 15,000 to 20,000 years. This, as you can imagine, makes the previously mentioned theories a lot less likely. Having coexisted for such a long time shows that the arrival of Homo sapiens did not push the Neanderthals to extinction, and that there is a different reason as to why they disappeared. I recently looked into one of the possible theories as to why Neanderthals could have disappeared from the face of the Earth. Here you can see the thumbnail. Thumbnail, look at it. It's not my best work, but I mean, it's a thumbnail. And I'll add it as a card in the upper right corner, and you can click on it if you want to learn more about the possible volcano eruption that drove them to extinction. A group of archaeologists and paleoanthropologists from the University of Toulouse, led by Ludovic Slimak, are responsible for the new discovery at the Mandrin Grotto, or cave if you will. The Mandrin site was first excavated in the year 1990, and the layers of archaeological deposits are stacked on top of each other in the sediment and go back as far as 100,000 years. Often, the Mandrin site is referred to as the Neanderthalian Pompeii, but without the catastrophic event of an erupting volcano nearby. Just to note, some archaeologists really like to call things with a similar name. So like the Neanderthalian Pompeii doesn't mean that it's Pompeii. Or like the Scottish Pompeii, Skara Brae, the Neolithic Pompeii, still not Pompeii. They call it a Pompeii because of the level of preservation. Just like Doggerland is usually called the lost European Atlantis. That doesn't make it Atlantis at all. It's not Plato's Atlantis. I've got that so much in my comments. But no, scientists and archaeologists and researchers often call things with a similar name that we already know because of the fact that it's similar in a sense. So like when they call something a Pompeii, it's the level of preservation that's pristine. It's insane. It's incomparable to other sites, except the level of preservation at Pompeii. And with like Doggerland, the lost European Atlantis, doesn't make it Atlantis. It means that it's a world that used to be lived on and is now undersea. So that's the similarity between Doggerland and Atlantis. Just, you know, for people, I already know that people want to like come at me in the comments. So like, come at me, bro. I'm so not funny. Continue. So this site really does get called the Neanderthalian Pompeii, often because of the pristine levels of preservation and the continuous filling of sands in the cave that was deposited by strong winds. There is a layer in the cave known as layer E, which contains around 1500 cut flint points. These flint points are more finely manufactured than the points in the layers below it, and even more finely manufactured than the flint points in the layers above it. So they are sandwiched between two layers of flint points that are really not close to their techniques and skill set. These points are quite small in size, some are even less than a centimeter in length, and they are perfectly worked up to the millimeter, which is something we've never seen Neanderthals do, according to Slimak, who specializes in Neanderthal societies. These probable arrowheads were unknown in Europe at the time, and he attributes the production of these to a culture called Neronian, and he has linked this culture to several sites in the Rhone area. So, I hear you think, why would Ludovic Slimak link these flint points to Homo sapiens? How can he be so sure? Well, of course, the fact that Homo sapiens remains have been found does give quite an indication, but there is another reason. In 2016, Slimak and his team went to the Peabody Museum in Harvard with their flint points to compare these discoveries to those found at the Ksar Akil site near Beirut in Lebanon, which is one of the major sites that show the expansion of Homo sapiens to the east of the Mediterranean. So in their trek from Africa, slowly making their way to like, you know, the Middle East, Western Asia, Eurasia, whatever, all that stuff. So the techniques used on the points found at the Mandrin Cave and at the Ksar Akil site show many similarities and therefore convinced Slimak that the findings at the Mandrin Cave in France were indeed the first traces of Homo sapiens in Europe. The team of researchers discovered a total of 9 teeth at the Mandrin Cave in this particular layer, and these belonged to 6 different individuals. 8 of these teeth belonged to 5 different individuals belonging to the Neanderthals. But there was one tooth from the E layer that belonged to a Homo sapiens, a modern human. This fossilized molar belonging to a modern human child is the earliest known evidence of modern humans in Western Europe. There is no clear evidence of cultural exchange in and around the cave between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, who alternately lived in and around the cave. Although in one case, it seems that the cave changed occupants in about 1 year from each other, which is quite a short time frame. But how did these researchers figure this out? Now that is one hell of a good question, and I will explain it to you. In the layers at the Mandrin Cave site, there are fragments of shelter walls and roofs that have fallen and have been buried with the fossils and artifacts. When the Neanderthals and Homo sapiens created fire at the site, the smoke would have left a layer of soot on the shelter walls and the roof. The following season, a thin layer of calcium carbonate called speleothem would cover the surfaces, and this cycle was repeated over and over again. These patterns can be read like tree rings, and this shows the researchers with what frequency and duration the groups inhabited the site. The research team was then able to determine how much time was in between the last Neanderthal fire and the first fire made by the group of Homo sapiens, and they discovered that it was not more than a full year between these two groups occupying the cave. The modern humans then occupied the Mandrin Cave every year for approximately 40 years, which is one or two generations long, and then they actually disappeared from the area nearly as suddenly as they had appeared, actually. After the modern humans left the area of the cave, the Neanderthals returned and regularly occupied the cave again and the immediate area. I mean, if you occupy a cave, you also occupy the immediate area for another 12,000 years. Information like this is key to understanding how different species or lineages lived in the same area around the same time. They might not have occupied the cave simultaneously, but they might have crossed paths in the time that the modern humans were occupying the cave. Of course, more work is still to be done, and I'm sure that as time goes by, that the Mandrin Cave will reveal a lot more of its secrets of the past to us. I mean, it has to, right? This is such an exciting time to be alive and interested in history, human evolution, and new archaeological discoveries. I feel like we're going to get spoiled with new information in the upcoming years, so to be completely honest, we better get ready for it. But with that said, if you enjoyed watching, then don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you like to see more of these kind of videos, and click that bell icon if you want to be notified whenever I upload or do an impromptu live stream, like I will when I'm in Malta. Also subscribe to Megalith Hunter. Okay, perfect. If you haven't seen my previous videos yet, then click the card in the upper right corner, or click one of the links in the description down below, or click a video in the end card. I cater to you. I'm amazing like that. I'd also like to thank my patrons and channel members. Thank you so much for supporting me and my work and the channel. You are making me feel like I'm worthy of your time, which is an amazing feeling. And yeah, I think I've blabbed enough. But yeah, Homo sapiens arrived earlier in Europe by at least 10,000 years. And I feel like we might even get another piece of information soon that it might even have been earlier as well. I don't know. What else are we going to uncover in the field of archaeology and history, and how much will we have to change the historic timeline? I hope a lot, because we've got way too many gaps at this point. And now I really have blabbed way too much, so I'll see you in the next video. Bye!